Hello, good afternoon. Good afternoon, Lucas. Good afternoon, Maggie. Good afternoon, Jaehoon. Let's listen to the song. Do you guys know this song? Maybe some Korean students. I'm gonna let you know why I play this song later, a little bit later. Okay, good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, Professor.
Everything's fine. No damage from typhoon. I hope everybody is fine. Okay. Make it larger. Okay, welcome back to my class. I just played a song, which is Korean song, titled Sometimes. So, do you guys know this song? Okay. actually find and read the lyrics of this song, the really is mainly about missing and those times she spent together with his with her ex boyfriend. So in some sense, memory may have some time value, right? If you miss the past time, sometimes you, as time went by, you miss those days that you had fun together with someone else you're now missing, right? So anyway, today we are talking about time value of memory, the time value of money. And based on this time value of money, we are going to talk about one valuation technique, which is discounted cash flow method. Okay, so today we are going to cover a very, very important topic. Okay, and I want you guys to have some concentration on today's class, because the time value of money will be used in many, many areas in corporate finance, okay? And DCF valuation as well. Okay, first of all, is there anyone who participate in UCLG Dejan event? Because if someone who participate in this event, then I think I should adjust the timing for midterm exam. So if you don't let me know right now, then I will just go ahead with my time schedule on a midterm exam. Okay, but after class, if you participate in this UCLG Dejan event, then just email me, okay? So then I will reschedule the midterm exam. You know what UCLG Dejan event, right? So this is a kind of international event held in Dejan. UCLG is a short for United City Local Government. So many representatives come to Korea, come to Deja for this event. Okay. But before we go to the time value of money, we should follow up on the previous. We have some slides to follow up on from the previous class. Okay, so one of the financial ratios you need to know is Dupont analysis. Stemmed from the Dupont company. You know, the very large chemical U.S. company. So finance team in Dupont company came up with this financial analysis. Okay. ROE, return on equity. So basically, the shareholders are very keen on the return on equity, right? Because they contributed a capital to the company, right? So then they want to know, they are very curious, they are very interested in the return on their equity investment, right? So which is return on equity, net income divided by total equity, okay? But the Dupont finance team broke down this ratio into more useful ratios, such as net income divided by sales, and the sales divided by asset, and asset divided by total equity. But in the end, these ratios also shows the same ratio as net income divided total equity. Okay, because the sales, this is denominator, right? Sales will be canceled off by the numerator of this ratio, right? And the asset will be canceled by this one, right? But from these three components, you can see the return on sales, right? You can see return on sales, and you can see return on asset, and you can see equity multiplier. So for example, yeah. So you can see more details. So you can see more detailed performance of the company by breaking down this return on equity into this way. Okay. So this is the DuPont analysis. So you can see what's the return for sales? What's the product? What's the sales amount for assets? What's the asset for equity, right? So you can see more you can see more closer look into the operations of the company using this DuPont analysis. Okay, so this is very so you can. You can break it down further, this internal equity, more different types of ratios. But this is a typical way of breaking down this internal equity, okay? So if you cancel these two, then you have a net income divided by asset, right? The return on asset, right? Then you have this one. Equal to multiplier and return on asset. So this is important, okay? So this is a very useful analysis to see how the company performs based on net income, sales, and asset versus total equity, okay? Mm-hmm. DuPont analysis. Any questions? No? Pretty simple. Okay.
So excuse me.
Okay.
I'm just asking because I was trying to check my attendance in the school app and it didn't let me. I don't know why.
Ah. Okay. I will check it out after class. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. No problem. Yeah, no worries about that.
Okay.
I will make sure you attended the previous classes. Okay. Yeah, so any question? No? Okay, so go ahead. So these are the ratios you need to be familiar with, okay? I think I didn't covered all the ratios in this class, but some of the important ones. I covered some of the important ones. So if you have some difficulties comprehending the logic behind these ratios, then just please let me know by sending email or whatever. Okay, so then I will, I'm gonna give you some more explanations on these ratios. Okay, so there's some important, the first one, every the first one, you should understand, first of all, you should know, you should, first of all, you should focus on, you should focus on the reason for using these ratios. First of all, short-term solvency or liquidity ratio, right? So you should keep in mind, you should keep this title in mind and then look into these ratios, okay? Long-term solvency, right? And asset utilization or turnover ratio and the profitability and market value ratio. So first of all, you should keep in mind, you should keep this big title in mind. And based on that, you should try to interpret these ratios or understand these ratios, okay? Because every ratio has its own purpose based on this title. Profitability, market value, asset utilization, long-term service, short-term service. Okay, that's very important. And here, this is kind of, this is also so, called the DuPont analysis, right? Okay, the financial analysis techniques. So why do we use, what's the ratios are for? Because of the, because we want to analyze the companies based on using the financial statements. That's how we use the financials. That's why the company publishes the financial statement to the public, and that's why we use the financial statement, because we want to analyze the financial statement, and based on that analysis, we're gonna value the company, and then you're gonna make investment decisions. Okay. So ratio analysis is one of the financial analysis techniques. The other one is a common size analysis. If you have, if you want to compare one company, if you want to know how well the company performed, then you may take some similar companies in the same line of industry, right? So then you can, similar size of the similar and with company with similar sizes. So then it's kind of an apple to apple comparison. So the, based on such techniques, you can also make some analysis of the company you are interested in. And you can also use, if you are good at some statistics, you can also use a regression analysis. Regression analysis is a statistical relation, is to find out statistical relationship between dependent and independent variables for forecasting. What does independent variables means that dependent is, it's like a function, right? So you know this function, right? This is very basic function. So this is dependable, right? Dependable variable. This is independent variable. So let's say this is the profitability, profit, right? Or this may be sales. Then there will be some independent variable that drives this profit or sales, right? So using the statistical techniques, you're gonna find out based on the past data, you wanna find out the relationship between these independent variables. For example, number of customers who visited the store, something like that. And the relationship between independent variables, dependent variables. So based on this analysis, you're gonna make a forecasting of the profitability of the company in the future. Okay, that's one of the techniques that you may use. You may use in in analyzing the company based on the financial statement. Okay. And more focused on what significant any changes in ratio can could bring about rather than one onto too much details of each ratio. Yeah, so when you try to understand this ratio, do not focus on memorizing the formulas, but understanding what the changes in ratios may mean. If the ratio is high, if the ratio is low, what does the changes in the ratios actually imply? That is the important thing you should understand, right? If the current ratio is high, is that good or bad? If the debt equity ratio is high, is it good or bad? Something like that, right? So that's the more important thing rather than memorizing the formulas, okay? That's what this point says. Okay, I don't have enough time. So if you have time, please try to solve these questions. If you have any questions, please email me. Because if I solve these three questions, then I may not cover today's class. Any questions? No?
Professor?
Yeah.
Do we have to remember all the radiation information, this kind of information for midterm exam?
I don't think so. As I said, I'm not in any exam you want to take test your own memory. Okay, so no question in my exam test your memory. Okay, just that most of my questions in the exam will test your understanding or conceptual understanding rather than memory. Okay. That's for sure. Okay, I will guarantee it. Okay, so as long as you understand these ratios, then there'll be no problems with any questions related to the ratios in the exam. Okay, is that okay?
Yes, it's okay.
Okay, great. So please try to solve these questions. So what is this? It looks like Earth and the Moon, right? this is one of the NFT. You know what NFT? Non-fungible token, right? I understand that this NFT, this was sold for very, very high amount. I mean, the price of this NFT was really amazingly high. So the reason I talk about NFT is that, yeah, basically NFT is a crypto art based on the blockchain, right? This is one of them. Today we are not talking about time value of money. So basically money and the time cannot be separated from one another. But sometimes the intangible or irrational sentimental characteristics more valuable than time, because basically, I don't know what kind of artistic features are in here in this work, but the price of this art work was was huge. So there's something that we sometimes don't understand in terms of value of many artist work or many different types of intangible object. So yeah, so NFT is about basically the value of NFT is, I think, is about something intangible or irrational or sentimental. So that's why I talk about NFT. Okay. So time value of money. What's time value of money? Time value of money is that the money in your hand right now, simply speaking, is more valuable than the money you're gonna have tomorrow, okay? Even at the slightest amount, money today is worth more than $1. $1 today is worth than $1 tomorrow, okay? That's the time value of money. Why? Because if you have $1 today, but if you just simply put the one, if you have $1 and put the money in your under your mattress, then it means nothing. Okay, that maybe it means nothing. But if you have $1 today, and there's always opportunity cost if you do not utilize the $1 today, right? For example, if you have $1 today, so what is the opportunity cost of $1? For example, you can deposit $1 with the bank, right? So then the banker is gonna pay very similar amount of interest on your deposit, right? That's the opportunity cost. So because of the opportunity cost, the money today, the money you have today is valuable than money you're gonna have tomorrow. Okay, that is the basic principle of time value of money. Okay, so by investing, so it depends on, among other things, the rate of return you can earn by investing. So investing, why? Because there is always an opportunity cost. So if you do not, opportunity cost. Opportunity cost makes $1 today more worth than $1 tomorrow. Okay. Understandable?
I have a question.
Question?
Yeah, I thought that my microphone is not working. So my question is so we don't need to invest in something. For example, I have certain amount of money and I can buy gold and invest in gold because the price of gold is increasing year by year. So it is not worth doing so.
Yeah, so if you have money, right? Okay, so investing and risk and return, right? You have money now, so then you're not, because if you do not use the money you have right now, then you may lose some opportunity cost, right? So for example, okay, so if I invest money in gold, then you expect some return from your investment in gold, right? So then if you are right, then you're gonna get some return on your investment in gold using $1 you have today. But if you do not, then so that's why $1 today is worse than $1 tomorrow. $1, let's say, investment period is 1 year, right? So if you have $1 1 year rather than $1 today, right? So then this one that, and you made an investment in gold and you get some return, let's say $5, right? So then in 1 year, you actually have $1 plus $5. So total $6, right? But if you supposed to receive $1 in 1 year, right? So then this $1 has lost about $5, the value of $5.
But we should not like keep this $1 in the pocket. We should like utilize it somewhere because of inflation. So
we should not
keep it like at home somewhere under a blanket.
Yeah, if you simply put the money into your pocket, and just let the time pass and you expected your $1 to grow. No, that's not what I'm saying. Because if you simply, the time value of money is this time, right? This time value always goes along with some interest rate. For example, interest rate. So when we talk about time value money, you should not forget about interest rate. So money, right? Money always goes with should go with interest rate, because you have money, right? So if you do not, you have money today, and you're gonna money the same amount of money, let's say tomorrow, right? Then this $1 and the $1 tomorrow is not the same. Why? Because if you invest $1 into invest, for example, if you deposit $1 into the bank with the bank, then you can earn interest. Right, even the slightest amount. Inflation rate. If you inflation rate is gonna discount this $1. If you just simply put the money in your pocket. Okay, inflation rate. The bank. Inflation rate may be already included in the bank's deposit rate. Okay, I wanna delete this inflation rate. Do you understand? Any understand? Hey, Yarina, I'm sorry, my pronunciation.
Yes, I understood.
Yeah, right, Lina? Okay. Okay. Okay, so the money today is more valuable. The same amount of money you're gonna have tomorrow, okay? That's the time value of money. But it does not mean that you simply keep the money in your pocket and then the $1 will be available tomorrow. Because the time value of money means that you wanna earn you're not gonna lose opportunity cost, right? In the future. That's the assumption when we talk about time value money. So if you have $1 today, then you're gonna $1 whatever money you have today, then you're gonna make investment. For example, deposit money with the bank so that you're gonna earn interest, right? That's why the money today is more valuable money, the same amount of money tomorrow. That's the time value of money. Understand? No problem? Okay, let's move on. So then future value and compounding. So now things are getting better. So the future, what is the future value? Future value is the amount of being compounded at a certain rate after one or more periods. So I have $1 today, right? So then, the reason why we use interest rate, we are not talking about risk-free rate at the moment. So this R interest rate is risk-free. Risk-free means that this return, right? If you deposit money, $1 with a bank, then almost certain that you're gonna receive the interest on your deposit, right? Without taking any risk. That is the consumption for the moment. Okay, to understand this time value of money. So we are gonna talk about risk in later lectures, but at the moment to understand the time value of money, we are not thinking of any risk, but just a risk-free rate, okay? Okay, so maybe this by investing means taking a risk, so maybe a little bit not completely correct, but I think you guys understand what I mean, right? So future value is if you have $1 and the interest rate is, let's say, one period of interest rate is R, so then one plus R multiplied by $1 is gonna be future value for one period. Right, so let's say one period is 1 year. So then you have $100. The interest rate, let's say 10%. Okay, here 10% interest rate, 10%. Then in 1 year, you're gonna have 110, right? So this is one plus, right? And you want to use this is an initial amount, right? And plus interest. So this one, principal amount interest, will be multiplied by, again, 0.1, right? So then this is compounded interest on interest, right? 100 plus 10, right? It was the initial amount, this one. And this is an interest, this one, right? So this 100 amount, the initial amount is multiplied by interest rate, right? This one. And this interest also multiplied by 10%. So interest on interest. Okay. So interest on interest is called compounding. Okay. So if you simply 0.12 times, right? Then you have this amount, right? This is the 100 multiplied by 1 plus 0.12 times, right? This one. Five. Okay. So the interest produced the additional interest. So it's compounded. This is the art of compounding. So if you draw a graph, so this is your initial amount, 100. Then if you deposit the money with the bank and which gives you 10% interest rate, it does not grow like this. It grow like this. Okay, not like this, like this, but it's compounded. Understand? Jiwon, you get it? Jiwon back, are you there? Back Jiwon, are you there?
Yes, Professor.
You get it?
Yes.
No? Oh yeah, yes and no, right?
I guess I get it.
Please. Anything unclear? Just let me know. I tried for to explain.
Professor, I'm confused. Do we use compound interest rate or simple interest rate?
Compounding. Simple interest rate. Okay, I'm gonna let you know the difference between simple and compounding interest. Okay. Just a minute.
Because like in what you wrote, you have the power of brackets, but in the formula that is typed, there is no power.
So if it is simple interest calculation, then the beginning amount is always 100. Okay. 100, okay, 100, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yeah. So in the simple, if it is not compounded, if interest is not compounded, then there's no interest on interest, only interest on principal amount is 100. So in the compounding, the compounded future value include interest on interest. But if it is simpler interest payment, then there is only interest on principal, this 100. So basically interest amount always 10, and at this time 10, and this time 100, and this time is 100 multiplied by, right, 2, then, yeah.
I mean that, like, here, there is no power, like, for compound interest rate, you wrote power here in the formula, but there is no power in the typed type text.
Yeah. Oh, here. This is the same as this 121. Because, hey, okay. I think I made you a little bit okay. I'm gonna a little bit slow down. Okay, this 100 is a principal amount you have right now, right? And this interest on $10, then it means that, okay, interest rate maybe it is 10%, right? You can guess from this interest amount, 10%. Then ending amount is 110. So based on this formula, right? This is 100. Right? 10%, 0.1, right? So this is the total return from investing $100 with the bank, right? Then this one is in the beginning amount is 110, right? So if you use this 110, right? Then if you multiply 0.1, then you're gonna have this one, right? But this is the same as 100. Two times. Because this is the 100 right? So if you simply this 110 is this one. So if you use this 110. This, if you change, substitute to this 100 with this one, right? So you have 2 times 1 plus 1.1, right? So 100 multiplied by 1.1 squared. So 121 is same as 100 multiplied by 1 plus 1.1 squared. So here, n. Yana, do you understand?
Yes.
Okay. Anyone who is not clear about this process? Okay. So this is a future value. Basically, simply speaking, the original amount you have is called the principal amount. Okay, this principal amount doesn't change. Okay, so principal amount doesn't change, but principal amount is compounded, right? And interest on the principal amount also compounded, right? So both interest and principal amount are compounded. A simple interest calculation, there's only principal amount principal amount, only interest is only added on to a principal amount, not interest to interest. Okay. But you don't have to think about the simple interest amount, because no bank use the simple interest calculation. I don't know, there may be some banks in any place in the world. So basically most countries. Okay, so it's the effect of a compounding interest. So it's getting larger, right? It's getting larger because of interest on interest. Okay, so as the interest rate is higher, getting higher, the future value is getting higher, right? So if the interest rate is 20%, then time value of money in the future is much higher, right? So when interest rate 20%, and then the opportunity cost is getting higher, right? If you do not put the money with the bank, which gives you 20% interest on the money you deposit, then yeah, the opportunity cost you're gonna lose is much higher, right? So time value of money always changes, not fixed. So sometimes the time value of money may be not negative, right? In Europe, not nowadays, in Europe, during the pandemic period, right? The interest rate was in the negative territory, right? The inflation, if you divide the money with a bank, so you actually supposed to pay interest back to the bank rather than receive interest from the bank, because its real interest rate was negative during the pandemic period. But now they raised the interest rate higher, but during the for some period, the real interest rate in Europe and America, still in Japan, the real interest rate is negative. But sometimes the time value of money could be negative in that case, right? I don't have time to read this article. So if you are interested, then please read this article. Present value and discounting. Okay, so future value comes with a compounding, okay? And present value comes with a discounting, okay? Because future value is the value in the future, right? So you should compound the value of the principal amount into the future, right? Using based on the interest rate. But present value means that you have, you're gonna calculate what is the value of money in the future back to the present, right? So you take the money backwards to the present, right? So which is called discounting. Okay, it's just a reversal of a future value. Reversal of a future value. So reversal of a compounding is discounting. Okay, so present value is not compounded. Present value is based on the discounting. Future value is based on the compounding. Okay, you get it? And it's just a reversal. Okay, so $1 divided by 1 plus R interest rate, right? This is T, T is time, period, right? This is just a reversal. Okay, present value. So let's say interest rate is 20%, right? I think it may be better to look at this table. As you can see, as the interest rate is getting higher, right? Present value is getting lower, right? You see, period one, right? Getting lower, period two, getting, so as the interest rate is high, the present value is getting lower. Because if you use, if the interest rate R, right, $1, right, as the this present for the present value, you should divide $1, the money you have, the money in the future. This is future value. The money you want to discount, you want to discount. It's getting lower if you use a higher interest rate. Because this interest is denominator, in the denominator. So if the denominator is higher, then the reserves is gonna lower. You guys get this formula? Okay.
Not really, Professor. I just don't understand, like, the value of what? A value of dollar or a value of a product?
Value of dollar and value of what?
Of a product, like of something that we bought, like, of a product.
Ah. Where? Product. No, yeah, I'm not talking about product. Product contains many, you should consider many things in the valuation of a product. So I'm not talking about the value of a product. I'm talking about value of money, the fiat money, dollar or ruble or the currency. Because product, depending on product, but we do not automatically add some interest onto the product, right? So I'm not talking about product. So I'm talking about $1, because $1 or any currency, because any currency has its own value guaranteed by the government, right? So if you deposit money with the bank, then there is always some interest added on to the money you deposit with the bank. So I'm talking about money. So as the interest, so this $1 is getting lower as the interest rate is higher, okay? In terms of present value, because you discount to a high interest rate in the denominator. Okay, good, bad. Okay, so future value and present value. So future value, present value, right? Future value is just simply multiply with 1 + r interest rate, square root of times, square root of period. And the present value is just a reversal of future value. Okay, like this. Pretty simple. I took, this is reversal. I used the picture to show the reversal of the future and present value. Reversal of future value is present value. Okay, this is summary of time value of money calculations. So mostly I covered. So I think you may take some time to be familiar with this concept. But simply speaking, just assume that, if I have money today, so I'm gonna put the money with the bank, which gives you interest. And the interest rate is risk-free, okay? We are not talking about we are talking about taking risk to make money, like investment stock or bonds. We are just talking about risk-free return, okay? When risk comes into this conversation, things are getting more complicated, okay? But we are gonna talk about a risk and return later. But for the time being, for the sake of understanding of time value of money, we are talking about risk-free return, this interest rate, okay? To understand the time value of money. You wanna also use the Excel to calculate the present value, future value, or interest rate, and the number of periods based on the initial amount and your future, your goal in the future. Just a minute. Can you guys see this spreadsheet? Let's say you have 1 million, okay? And you wanna make this 1 million, 2 million. So then, let's see. No, first of all, let's talk about. Okay, you wanna make $2 million, for example. And then interest rate is 5%. And then you want to make this $2 million within 5 years, right? So then how much you should invest? How much you should deposit with the bank, which gives you 5% interest rate per year? That is the question of a present value of this $2 million, based on the five-year investment period, five-year deposit period, and 5% interest rate. So then you can use, you can calculate this present value using, if you have a financial calculator. So if you don't, then you can take, this is Korean, sorry, but a formula, this is in Korean, this in English, Korean formula, and finance. And if you go down to, scroll down, present value, PV, sorry, FV. PV, present value, okay? So let me see. Finance, present value, rate, 5%, right? And instant payment, no instant payment. The number of a period, 5 years, five. And instant payment, no. Future value, 2 million. And this time means that you're gonna make investment in the beginning or in the end. So in the beginning, then you're gonna put one, okay? So then you can get the present value. So why minus? Because you take out money from your pocket and into the bank. So the cash flows out of you. So that's why it is negative. And this is positive because it comes into you. Okay. So if you deposit 1,567,052 with the bank, which provides you 5% interest rate over the five years, then you're gonna have 2 million. Okay. So I recommend you use these Excel functions, okay, to calculate present value. Not just present value, but future value as well. If you go to here, present value. So what is the present value you can use? Right now I have, I'm gonna take some questions. Okay, this is most you guys are girls. The girls may not have interest in cars, but because the question mentions a car. So this is Ferrari, right? So you are trying to save to buy a new $175,000 Ferrari, right? So you have $35,000 today. That can be invested in your bank. The bank pays 2.9% annual interest on its account. How long will it be before you have enough to buy the car, right? So you have $175,000. This is present value, right? You have $35,000 you have today. This is present value. And then what is the future value? $175,000, right? So then, how, so you wanna make this $35,000 into $175,000 by investing money with the bank, which pays you 2.9% interest rate per year. So how long should you put the money into the keep the money in the bank? So then you're gonna also use Excel spreadsheet. Okay, so and finance here, right? Period, the investment period. Interest rate, 2.9%. Payment. No, we only have this initial amount. Present value, $35,000. So this is cash outflow, right? It's negative. Future value should be $175,000. Tie, we're gonna pay in the beginning, so one. So then, yeah, 65.3 years. So it takes at least 56 years at least. So if you invested the $35,000 with the bank, which pays 3.29 for 56 years, then you can buy this Ferrari. Okay, this is how you calculate the number of period it takes to get the future value based on the current initial amount you have. So try to use this Excel functions to calculate the present value, future value, number of periods, or sometimes the interest rate. Okay, it is just to find out the variables, one variable. Okay. Any questions? Okay. So I think, I don't know, but if you guys are a little bit serious about the finance, then I think it is useful to have this financial calculator. Okay. So if you have a financial calculator, then you would have to use this Excel. You can get the numbers, the present value, future value, interest rate using this financial calculator. So BA2 plus Casio, so whatever. I mean, financial calculator will be very useful. Okay. So in the exam, you are free to use this financial calculator. Okay. Okay. If you go to Dangdong Market, the Karam Market, you can get some the second-hand one. Okay, you know what Karam Market, the second-hand market in Korea. Anyway, okay, so the discount cash flow method. Discount cash flow method is the let's say we have cash flows in the future, right? Okay, why do we use this discount cash flow method? Why do we have to learn this? Because we are talking about valuation in finance. Valuation means that you wanna know the actual value of investment. For example, if you want to make an investment in stock or bonds, or if you make then you want to know the value of the stock, the value of a bond, right? So then there are many different types of techniques to make a valuation of the stock or bonds. So one of the ways is to use this discounted cash flow method. So as you can see from the as the name implies, we are discounting cash flow, okay? Discounting, right? Discounting cash flow means that we want to know present value of cash. So we discounting what? We already discounting cash, right? So discounted cash flow method is another name. It's a little bit, it's named for to find out present value of future cash flows. That is the discounted cash flow method. The why do we use this discounted cash flow method? One of the valuation method is to find the present value of cash flows from your investment. For example, stock, bonds, right? If you make investment stock, then you're gonna earn some dividends or capital gains, right? If you make investment in bonds, then you're gonna make some interest from the bonds. So those interest, dividends, capital gains are all in the end cash flows, okay? So in finance, cash is the king. So they want, but those cashes are generated in the future, not now, right? So all the cashes we are now, right? But all the cashes generate in the future, right? Cash, right? Depending on the type of investment, it may be in the form of a dividend, in the form, you know what dividend is, right? Okay, dividends, or it may be in the form of interest, or it may be in the form of capital gains, right? So if you make investment, or it may be a rental fee, right? Or it may be, if you talk about the valuation of a company, it's gonna be cash flow from company, right? So we discount these cash flows to value our investment or company. Because we are talking about corporate finance, right? The company makes investment, short-term investment or long-term investment. Usually long-term, when it comes to long-term investment, the long-term investment is supposed to generate cash, right? In the name of revenues, in the end, after expenses, in the name of a profit, net income, right? So the company is going to make some investment, for example, some equipment, right? Some or they want to set up a new factory, right? Or new equipment, new machine, right? When if it is long term investment, then the magnitude of investment may be very huge, right? So then there's supposed to be the cash flows from those investments. So then based on the then we're gonna discount cash flows to see whether that investment is worth versus initial versus cost. Okay, the discount. So then what you need is discount rate, right? Without discount rate, there's no way to discount the cash flow. So discount rate is the rate used to calculate the present value of future cash flows, right? So this DCF is calculating the present value of a future cash flow as a way to find a fair value. Yeah, as a way to find fair value, intrinsic values in another name. So John Burr Williams is the person who come up with this discount cash flow method. So intrinsic value of an asset or enterprise is the present value of all expected future cash flows to the company. It is calculated by a discount cash flow valuation. So if you want the real value of a company or an asset, asset includes a stock or bonds, right? One of the ways is to calculate the present value of the future expected future cash flows, right? Simple, pretty simple, right? We're just talking about present value and future value. And future value, probably, yeah, cash flows in the future. So we discount all the cash flows in the future back to the present using discount rate. But discount rate is already changes, depending on discount rate is very complicated. Discount rate is based on very many factors, okay? But for the time being, you simply understand that the DCF method is based on the discounting of future cash flows using discount rate, okay? I have only 5 minutes. Next time, next class, next lecture, I'm gonna use this DCF method. To calculate present value. Okay. First, we want to take a look at future value with multiple cash flows. Okay.
So next class, we're going to have a practical lesson.
Practical lesson? Oh, yeah. This one. Okay. Let's say you want to buy this. The Mercedes, right? And then you don't have enough cash right now, right? So you're gonna make a down payment, okay, $10,000, and then after tax and fees, then the total amount of finance is $90,000 around. So then based on our based on our knowledge on present value, future value, we are not calculate. We are gonna find out how this monthly payment come out. Okay. I took out these numbers from the site. This site. So anyway, yeah. So this is a pretty related to your everyday life in the future. Okay. Even if not now. Okay. And I'm going to also talk about, I'm going to also use the jackpot case. So this is a very important case to understand the time value of money, which means present value, future value, and the discount rate. So I'm going to use this jackpot case to enhance your understanding in the next class. So, and I'm going to also talk about annuity payments. So, annuity payment is the, and the perpetuities and the effective annual rate and the annual percentage rate. So, yeah. So, next class, we are going to talk about a little bit more about present value and future value and discount cash flow method. Any questions up to now? No? Jiang Yu, any questions? Jiang Yu?
No, I don't.
No?
No.
Really? Everything is understood?
Yes,
yeah, okay. Yes. Okay, that's excellent. That's excellent. Minja? Do you Minja?
Yes, Professor.
You're from?
This is my name, and I understand what you taught us.
Okay, you're from which country?
I'm from China.
Ah, China. So you basically understand what I told you?
Yes.
Okay, that's great. Okay, so I want you guys to have some time, okay, to get better understanding on the concept of future value, present value, and the compounding, discounting, okay? So if you have any questions, just send an email. But I'll try to help you guys understand better.
Thank you.
Okay, so you guys have a next class. Okay, so see you this Thursday. Okay, by then.
Thank you, professor.
Professor, I have a question about attendance.
Sure.
I couldn't attend last week because of some issues. It is the first time I'm attending this class.
Okay.
So I don't know how to check my attendance. Is there another platform to check our attendance?
Okay, I'm gonna take care of that. Okay, so I'm gonna make you attend.
All right. Is our class going to be online all the time?
Oh yeah, you can check it. I put up all the lectures onto the LMS, and you also watch the watch this lecture on the YouTube channel. So you can please visit the LMS.
All right. So is there any other platform to check our attendance?
Yeah, YouTube channel.
All right. I understand.
So there's a link on the LMS. LMS.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, then you can watch this previous class on the YouTube. Yeah.
Professor.
Yeah.
I'm going to participate in UCLG event.
Oh, you.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I see. Wan Young Cho. When? How long?
Event will held in October. So we October 12th.
October. I see. So then you're gonna be pretty busy up to October 12, right?
Yeah.
I see. You're the only one in this class participate in the UCLG?
I'm not sure.
Oh, okay. Okay, thank you very much for letting me know that. Okay, so then I'll try to just museum schedule. Okay, any other questions? No? Okay, so then see you this Thursday.
Thank you, Professor.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.